Topic this morning relates with legal status of Hadith. And the reason we have taken this topic is, in our everyday life, we talk about two important sources of Islam. The first source is Quran, and second is Hadith or Sunnah. However, in our minds, we have a common confusion that the Quran is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's revelation, a book which is beyond any doubt. But Hadith is perhaps a matter of verbal traditions, reports, discussions going on, stories being circulated, and ultimately, after several centuries, collected and recorded. We also have a common understanding that Hadith is perhaps something secondary. Major thing is to follow the Quran. Therefore, if we follow the Quran, we will succeed. If we discuss Hadith and try to find out what does it say, we'll be confused and we'll have conflicts. These are the common misgivings that exist. And for that reason, we thought there should be a discussion, a quick one, on what is the legal status of Hadith and Sunnah. For that, we first run down on the meaning of the term, and we find its meaning in Arabic relates with communication, story, or conversation. The term appears 23 times in the Quran, just as you find here, Allahu nazzala ahsan al-hadith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed the fairest of statement. It's one example. Similarly, we find the term sunnah, which also means literally the way, course, rule, mode of or manner of action or conduct of life, or a continuous practice. This also appears in the Quran 27 times, and again I give an example, sunnatullahi fil ladina khalaw, and that refers to practice and tradition, as we said a while ago. The term hadith or sunnah is defined in three very simple words. First, fail or action. Second, call or statement. Third, taqreer or endorsement. And that means if there is a statement which tells us about an action of the Prophet, tells us about his statement, or tells us something was done in his presence, he never objected, he endorsed it, then all three constitute what we call hadith or sunnah. Now there are various forms in which it has existed in the lifetime of the Prophet. In his lifetime, he wrote letters, he delivered sermons, he wrote ahkam or directives. There were personal records of the Sahaba, and then there were sahaif or small facsimiles, records of companions who wrote down a hadith, and for that we find these were recorded by a number of companions. I just give very quickly a rundown on their names, their date of birth, and that tells you that this is not a matter of 2nd century, 3rd century, when some historians or some muhaddiseen come up and then they discover a hadith, but it is a continuity. Number of traditions reported by them, their date of death, which means before they died in 58 or 40 or 32 or 60, they were already providing that much number of ahadith in written form, recorded form, and as such, the whole story that ahadith are a matter of later development is a misconception. I here also give you the source. you can find this information in a number of books. In the second level of reporters, we have what we call tabi'in, and these tabi'in also indicate an unbroken chain of continuity. You find these people who learn directly from companions, communicated these ahadith to the later generation. So the whole idea that we have a gap in the middle, and then we have some muhaddiseen coming up, is not founded on any historical facts. Now, what's the meaning of this term hadith and sunnah in the Quran? For that, we will like to look into Quran, and there you find sunnah very clearly stated as the example of the Prophet. And therefore, first thing we find is that following the sunnah of the Prophet is an article of faith. Those who are believers, they are supposed to follow not only the Quran but also the Prophet. And that is indicated in all these references. You will have a copy of these references later on. I don't have much time to go in details. We find again the Quran telling us that whatever Prophet is doing is to be fully imitated, is to be taken as the criterion and observed unconditionally. So the Quran tells us that indeed in his example we have put for you something which you are to follow. It does not leave it for me to choose should I follow or not, but the Quran gives a very clear command, and that's why we find these statements in various places telling us that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the prophets for certain purpose, and their purpose is here illustrated in Surah Al-Baqarah and other places that will follow, telling us that Prophet communicates ayat of Allah, gives them wisdom and education in book, and then purifies them. These are the functions of the Prophet given in various Quranic passages. Then we come to the last reference, which says that if you think you really love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قُلْ كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِ, say, if you love Allah, follow me. Does not say follow the Quran, but follow me. The words are so clear and so outspoken that if anyone simply reads the Quran, there cannot be any confusion. We have many other references. I'm just passing very fast so we can use more time for questions. You find here superiority of the prophetic action is given by the Quran in very clear words, that he is not like any other ruler, administrator, executive officer who can be sometimes followed and sometimes you reconsider, but there cannot be a deviance from his following. And all these references talk about the same aspect. Similarly, you find in these references from the Quran tells us that if Prophet has decided any matter, then they cannot disagree with it. Here it is said that those who are believers, they should follow Allah and Prophet, and they should not void their actions. Tabtilu amalakum. In our own language, we use batil for void, for something wrong. And here again it is said that if you are going to differentiate, discriminate, or give it a low priority, then you are going to lose all your actions. You are a loser. In the last reference, it tells us that Prophet is fully guided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in all matters. When he is saying something, doing something, it's not his own, not from his own self, but directly from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now comes that aspect which is in our topic, the legal dimension of hadith or sunnah. And here you find in first reference that Quran makes it very clear, the Prophet ya'murhum bil ma'ruf wa yanhahum anil munkar wa yuhillu lahum at-tayyibat wa yuharrimu alayhim. He makes things halal for you, he declares what is right and wrong and what needs to be abstained completely. It is not said that we do it, but it is the Prophet who declares what you should do in your matters and what things will be halal for you and haram for you. Here again the Quran tells us, take from Prophet whatever he gives you and stop from whatever he stops you. Then the Quran further tells us that your attitude towards him should be of, you always tell the you respond by saying sami'na wa ata'na. Now why is it done? Why we have to say sami'na wa ata'na? The Quran answers and tells us, we have never sent Prophet except with our permission to be followed. That it's we who want him to be followed, not that you are impressed by his personality, by his charisma, by his unique aspects, start following him. No, it is we who command you to follow. And therefore it continues and says, indeed no one will be a believer unless he takes his tahkim or his decisions as final, and therefore he has to be taken as a legal source and legislator. Here again you find the Quran says, وَمَنْ يُتَيَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَ فَأُولَٰئِكَ مَا الَّذِينَ عَنَمَ اللَّهُ إِلَى الْآخِرِ, that these are the people who are going to be blessed and who are going to be rewarded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It further tells us, it's not one, but you find so many references in the Quran that tell you about obedience unconditionally and in all matters, whether they are legal, moral, economic, political, in everything you have to take the prophetic decision and his example as final. Therefore here you find again a reference to ita'ah of the Prophet, and then it tells us that if there are people who are observing what the Quran and Sunnah has said, you will follow them. But when a dispute arises between those who are scholars, authorities, rulers, and what the Quran and Prophet has said, then you are not going to accept them as authority. So the Quran says, O you who are believers, أَتِيُوا اللَّهَ وَأَتِيُوا الرَّسُولَ وَأُولِي الْأَمْرِ مِنْكُمْ فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُّوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. Those who are believers, they should follow Allah, His Prophet, and those in authority. But if dispute arises, then only follow Allah and Prophet. Don't follow your rulers. Unfortunately, for centuries we were told, since the Quran has said, follow the rulers, follow them whatever they tell you. But never for once they read the whole ayah. The whole ayah makes it very clear, فَإِن تَنَازَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرْدُوا لِلَّهِ وَالرَّسُولِ. does not say you still continue following the rulers, but only follow Allah and His Prophet. Which means these two are to be followed in all situations. So you find here the Quranic judgment. مَنْ يُطَعِ الرَّسُولَ فَقَدْ أَطَعَ اللَّهِ. One who follows the Prophet follows Allah. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in so clear words, and someone comes and tells us, well, I will follow only the Quran, not the Prophet, then whom does he follow? The Quran or his own self? When the Quran commands you to follow the Prophet, and you say, no, I will not follow the Prophet, but the Quran, then whom are you following? Your own self, your own desire. So if we simply go to the Quran, it provides us ample evidence, and therefore the Quran tells us that these are the people who follow Allah and Prophet, whom we categorize as the true believers, and so on and so forth. And lastly, we find these few references which again reinforce what has been said earlier regarding the legality of the prophetic example, and then a warning that tells us very clearly, and when it is said to them, come unto thou, which Allah has revealed, and unto the messenger, thou see the hypocrites turn away from you with aversion. The Quran gives a warning that when you invite them to follow these two things, Allah and yourself, then you find the hypocrites saying, we'll follow Allah, but not you. So the Quran has very clearly warned, and lastly, it says that you should follow Allah, and you should not destroy the Prophet, and you should not cause any kind of problem for yourself by hesitating. Now, with all that said, what is the problem? The problem essentially is that we have not been able to orient ourselves, inform ourselves, and find out for ourselves what is the nature of recording of the Quran and recording of Hadith or Sunnah. We are quite often informed by people that there are, now we can have lights back if you like, that there are people who fabricated Ahadith, there are people who came up with certain reports which were never said by him, and therefore we have no idea when we read a book of Hadith what is right and what is wrong. You also hear that Hadith has a number of categories. Among those, some are what are known as Sahih, and some which are known as Hasan, and some which are known as Daif. And since a normal person is not a professional, therefore people think that if we are unable to detect a Hadith is Sahih, Hasan or Daif, we may do things which may be wrong. These three terms and many others make subject matter of a whole discipline which we call Mustalahat al-Hadith, Hadith terminology. In that, we define very clearly what is meant by one category or the other. It is just like you go to a university, register in a course, in sociology, in history, philosophy. And after you have done your term papers and exams, you go to the registrar's office and you find a transcript which says, in philosophy, you got an A. In political science, you have a B. In psychology, you got a C. In economics, an F. Then you ask, what is this A, B, C, and F? They tell you, A means you have been able to get 80% and above. B is you have been able to get 70% and above. C is when 60%, and F is below 50. Similarly, these terminologies tell us about what kind of category is that of Hadith. The term Sahih never means correct. It only means it follows a level of what we call internal and external validity. Internally and externally evaluated and found of certain category. What is this category? This category is, firstly, that the reporter is Muslim, that reporter is adult, that reporter has a sound memory, that reporter has taqwa or a conduct which is known. The reporter has taken the report directly by either listening or by getting a written record from his teacher. The reporter was able to maintain his level of memory throughout the period he was reporting. If in any period of his life, say after 50, 60, he became a bit lapser, he will forget things, then they are going to put a question mark and the category will fall down from Sahih to Hasan. Does not mean it is weak, does not mean it is wrong. It's a slight difference of shades. That's why when you open the book of Bukhari or Muslim, you find a report, and at the end of the report, Bukhari or Muslim says, this is Sahih, this is Hasan. And that's why their books are known as Siha. Siha means those books in which only those traditions are reported which fall in these two categories. But what is this third category? Does that mean a hadith is very, very weak, unreliable? Not at all. Zaif never means unreliable. Zaif only means that this hadith does not meet the criteria of Sahih and Hasan. At one point, it has less degree than both. That makes it Zaif. Does not mean it is fabricated, it is wrong, unreliable, unauthentic, nothing like that. Nevertheless, when you read books and listen to lectures and see some writings of people, they say, well, some hadith is daif, some is strong, some is so. How do I know? You know, if you open the book of hadith, every single book of hadith at the end of a report puts in parentheses, in brackets, Sahih, Hasan, Daif. Doesn't leave it to you. The experts have done job for you. And since Daif does not mean false and fabricated, only a matter of shade, therefore even a number of Daif ahadith will be used for several purposes. They may not be used for execution, for deciding matters in murder, in rape and other matters, but they will be still a basis for many other legislative processes. Therefore, when you read such terms, don't be misguided by their literal translation. Literally, a hadith sahih means correct, as you hear, means good, means weak, but these are not categories done literally. These are technical terms, and technically they stand for something different than what we understand. Secondly, people say that hadith is anyhow a matter of prophet, he said something. But Quran is a matter of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself sending revelation. A simple question is, suppose someone comes and asks the Prophet, "Sir, can I eat pizza?" And he said, "Never eat pizza," for argument's sake. Do you think when he is saying it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is on vacation? He will never send the revelation. The simple man asks you, "Can I eat pizza?" And to best of our knowledge, it has only cheese, some flour, some garlic, some onions, some tomato, some mushrooms, and all these we declared halal. Why you said don't eat pizza? For 23 years, as prophet, people come to him. He tells them many things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, na'uzu billah, absent, never taking care of what Prophet is saying and telling people, never sending a revelation. "Sir, why you said it?" Once, when he is sitting with his wife, and his wife says, "I smell something very strange from your mouth." And he said, "I have taken nothing but some honey before coming to you." "Okay, I'll take no more honey." The story is over. It has nothing sensational, nothing so important that you call a press conference and then say, "Prophet has said I will take no more honey." If you drink coffee and black coffee, and you go to your wife and she says, "You smell black coffee," and you say, "Okay, I'll not drink any more coffee," does it bring a conflict in Israel? Does it cause a havoc in Indonesia? Something so common. Revelation comes in the Quran and says, "Sir, what we made permissible for you, you cannot make haram for yourself." In such matters, which are of no political importance, no strategic importance, the world would not collapse if he never took honey again. The Quran never keeps itself silent. Allah never disregards what his Prophet has said. But when the Prophet was stoning a lady or a young person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never sent the revelation. Why you kill the person innocent? We send the Quran, 100 strips for an adulterer, and you stone the person. How come you did it? Therefore, you will find a number of quite educated, enlightened people saying, the punishment for zina in the hadith, stoning to death, show us the ayah in the Quran. The same argument. They fail to understand, it's not just the Quran which is legislative. It is the Quran and the Sunnah equally that legislate, that provide legal framework for the Muslim Ummah. Therefore, if certain things are not given specifically in the Quran, but those are provided by the Sunnah, they carry same importance and legal validity. if their argument of show us the ayah of Rajam is stoning to death and we will accept it as Islamic law, if their argument holds any water, then they should show us the ayah in the Quran which tells us how should I raise my hands up to my ears or shoulders, and where should I bind my hands, and should I say Al-Fatiha in the beginning or when I end my prayer, should I bow down first or go to sijda first, should I make all my prayer by sitting or by lying down in the bed. Show us one single ayah in the Quran that tells us how should we perform our prayer. Show us one single ayah in the Quran that tells us what is the sequence of manasik of Hajj, and what is the farida of Hajj, and what is sunnah of the Hajj. Can I mix up the things and do as I like, or I must follow a certain way of doing things? Tell us one single ayah from the Quran which shows that when you pay zakah, then pay zakah so much and not so much. Which means it's just begging a wrong approach. It is not logical and scientific to say, show us in the Quran and we will follow. And so long it is mentioned only in Hadith or Sunnah, it has less validity or less importance. To conclude, when we talk about these two Islamic sources in our everyday life, then for legal purposes, moral purposes, for our everyday living, we cannot draw a line between the legality and applicability of the Quran and the Sunnah or Hadith. Any questions? Sir?
Sir, the role of Ahle Bayt.
Yes.
In compilation of Hadith.
Yes.
Because as I have seen on the U file, the references which you have shown, none of them.
Hazrat Ali's name was there, Ibn Abbas' name was there, and a number of others were there. And therefore, it's not a matter of Ahle Bayt or non-Ahle Bayt. We don't have that categorization in our history. It's a very late development of our theology. The theological developments are not legal developments. And therefore, if you look into it, you find here Ali ibn Abi Talib, who is regarded as one of Ahl Bayt. But Sayyida Aisha is no less than Ahl Bayt. The people who were getting from him traditions are no less than Ahl Bayt. The problem is that we take Ahl Bayt in terms of those persons who trace their genealogy to Sayyida Fatima or Sayyidina Ali. In the Quran, the term is used for anyone who follows the Prophet and his deen. Therefore, the Ahle Bayt of the Prophet Yaqub, the Ahle Bayt of Isa, the Ahle Bayt of Harun, all these terms are used in the Quran to indicate that they are from your household, to the extent that the Quran says the wife of a prophet who did not follow his deen, the Quran says she is not from your Ahle Bayt. The son of the prophet who disobeyed and was drowned, the Quran is not from your Ahle Bayt. Blood does not mean anything in Islam. In Islam, following is the basis of being Ahl. Why do we say Bani Israel? We say Bani Israel not because genetic Bani Israel, but because they followed the Sunnah of Sayyidina Yaqub. Therefore, the Quran calls them Bani Israel. So the whole concept of Ahl Bayt is a later development of our history. It never existed in the Quran, nor among companions. No one ever said, Ali, you are Ahle Bayt, and Aisha, you are not Ahle Bayt. The other wives of Prophet are not from Ahle Bayt, but only Sayyida Fatima from Ahle Bayt. This is a very late development which is not founded on the Quran and Sunnah. Yes, and the question, please? Ji.
Can you give us the exact timing of these with the Holy Prophet?
I have it somewhere else, not in these notes, but I have a whole table which indicates the date of birth and death of major Muhaddiseen.
I mean to say that how much time they spent with the Holy Prophet?
Who? They spent most of their time with him.
Sir, I have a doubt. Last day I read a book, Mother of the Mera, that he embraced Islam on the event of Zakat.
No, this is not correct. You see, Abu Huraira is one of the reporters who has large number of ahadith.
Probably the largest.
Yes, but that does not mean that since he has largest number of ahadith and he was not a companion in Makki period but in Madani period, therefore we can doubt his reports. The fact of the matter is, if we go to his life history, we find that he was about 12 years when he became Muslim. When he came, he came from Makkah, and his mother and his family were so much against his becoming Muslim that they even deprived him of his body dress. He had to borrow a sheet to cover himself. They took everything from him. When he came, the Prophet asked him, "You stay in the masjid and you will learn." And therefore he became one of the earliest students of the University of Suffa. He will stay there most of his time, like Anas stayed with Prophet most of his time in his home. And therefore he was able to collect more ahadith as compared to others, which is logical and rational. No, this is wrong. This is wrong.
Sir,
this is wrong.
About the definition of Ahle
Bayt. Yes.
There is a hadith in Nisa. And there are verses in Quran that Inna ma yu'minu bi Allah and Murissa and Bayt and Nazar. These are the people who are your Ahle Bayt, from whom I have removed all the najas, and they I have made them pure and pure. What about your opinion?
You see, when the Quran declares something, no one can have an opinion. When the Prophet declares something, no one can have a second opinion on that. But what does that mean? Does that mean that we define family in terms of only daughter and son-in-law, or family in terms of wives and children? What is our common sense understanding from Abrahamic and days of Sayyidina Adam? The common sense understanding is, which exists even today, in the secular world or Islamic world, family is never defined as a narrow circle of one aspect, but family means husband, wife, children, who are living in one single place, part of a system. Therefore, when the term Ahle Bayt is used, it is not a matter of confining it to only one daughter. The other daughters are also part of family. Wives are part of family. When the Quran is saying something, it is for all those Ahle Bayt, not just for one single aspect. Doesn't make difference at all. In the Quran, doesn't make difference at all. You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a particularist. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows very well what is being said, and companions know very well what is being said. None of the companions had that understanding which we have today. They never understood the Quran in that manner. And that's why we have a different interpretation. There can always be difference of interpretation, but we have to go back to find out, does it exist in the lifetime of Prophet and companions? If they have that understanding, well and good. Otherwise, it could be one interpretation. And when we interpret something, we have every right to observe it. Does not mean that becomes for everyone an obligatory thing. So when some scholars are of a view, they have every right to follow it. But they cannot say, since what we understand is the truth, we will always have more than one interpretations. And so long as a basis exists, we cannot declare it completely void. Sir.
So it means that Hazrat Abu Huraira رضي الله عنه can be included in, or he is elevated from elevated.
No, I never said it.
I just want to clarify myself.
No, you see, I never said. I said that the term Ahle Bayt cannot be confined. Sure. Rather, it refers to the whole family of the Prophet. Sure. And all those who are the nasl, all. Sure. That all refers to everyone. Sure. Who is following the Sunnah. Sure. Like Ali Imran, Ali Yaqub, Ali Ibrahim. Sure. Why do we say in our salam, not only on the aal of Sayyidina Muhammad sallam, but on the aal of Ibrahim? Why we say it? Simple reason. Those who are followers of right way deserve prayer. You see, in Islam, we have failed to understand. It is not a matter of, oh Allah, please bless me and bless no one else. But it's a matter of, oh Allah, please bless me and bless everyone. Therefore, when someone comes and addresses to the Prophet a similar situation, that I pray for this thing and for no one else, he stops him from that. In our religion, you look for anything. Salam on the Prophet is not just on him. It is prayer for the whole of Muslim Ummah. When we say Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin sallallahu alaihi wasallam wa ala ali Muhammadin kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim, this is the beauty of Islam, that anyone who is in the ali of Ibrahim, ali Muhammad, all of them. And ali Muhammad is not just people who are blood relations, like ali Ibrahim, not blood relations, ali Yaqub, not blood relations, but all those who followed them. When a common example to illustrate is, when we go and make our Salatul Janaza, what do you say? Allahumma ghfir li hayyina wa mayyitina wa shahidina wa ghaibina wa saghirina wa kabirina wa zakarina wa unsana. Ay Allah, we seek your blessing and prayer and forgiveness for those who are present, who are not present, those who are minor, those who are major, those who are women, those who are men. We do every single possible collection of human beings who are Muslims. Although we pray apparently for only one person. Salatul Janaza is for the one who has died, lie in front of you. But while you are praying for him, you pray not only for him, but for everyone who has earlier or later or now or not present. The beauty of Islam is, in everything it has a collectivity. It is not that, O Allah, bless only Prophet and his daughter and his children, and don't bless anyone else. That is essentially something anti-Islamic ethos, Prophet by Prophet. Therefore, collectivity exists for the whole Muslim Ummah. That brings us together. The family of the Prophet has always been in the hearts of Muslims. The family of Prophet deserves more respect than anyone else. But that does not mean I pray to Allah and say, O Allah, pray only, bless only Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and not Ibrahim. Please only bless Prophet Muhammad and his few children, but not any other one in the Ummah. That will be completely contrary to our understanding of Islam. So Islam is essentially a matter of collectivity in which we pray for them, we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing on them, but add others to that. Any? Hadith says very clearly, there is only one situation in which you can misstate or you can make a lie, and that is when you want to unify husband and wife or create peace between two brothers. Then you can tell a lie to bring them together. But our practice is to fabricate lies to divide people, not to bring them closer. And if we find out by any means someone does not like the other person, then we concoct not one but hundreds of stories and add spice to it and go and tell the person, so and so was talking about you in this manner, to provoke, to create more problems. So only one possibility that Hadith allows is when you want to bring peace among husband and wife or two brothers. No other situation. Pardon?
I mean, the base of that friendship or whatever between the husband and wife,
yes,
is going to be the basis. I mean, somebody has said lie and brought them together. Is it not a...
You see, their base of becoming husband and wife was never a lie. That was a public statement. Something halal, not haram. And therefore, if you bring it back on same situation, not doing anything wrong. If the base was wrong for them, then you can have a point. But since the very relationship is pure, legal, legitimate, moral, ethical, a crack has appeared. Repairing it is bringing back purity, truth, honesty, and fairness. And therefore, it's not going to cause any problem in that.
But it is not in Quran, a lot of religion.
That's what I said just now, that the whole argument, show us in the Quran, is a wrong argument. The argument should be, show us in the Quran and Hadith. Both complement each other, and we cannot differentiate. That's why I showed you slides. This was the reason to show you the continuity of the reporters. It's a total false statement that it was collected after 125 years. It's completely wrong and baseless, based on ignorance. Try to find out from facts of history, not from hearsay. Facts of history are different than hearsay. And I don't claim I have discovered these things. I give you sources which can be checked, and you can go and read yourself in those books. exact statements by people who have devoted their life in that discipline. Those who carry their PhDs in only science of Hadith. Pardon? Yes. What stops us from that if the Quran says so? Didn't the Quran say, if you love Allah, follow Prophet? Didn't the Quran say, Mayyute Rasoola Fakat Ata Allah? If someone follows Prophet, he is following Allah. It's not a Hadith. It's Quran. Then if I follow the Prophet, whom I follow? Whom do I follow? This is a problem which from childhood you have inherited. You have been given wrong informations, hearsay, not facts. But read the Quran. I'm not giving you my own arguments. I'm just showing you what the Quran has said. If the Quran says, Mayyute Rasoola Fakat Ata Allah, then it means one who follows the Prophet is following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I think it's so obvious, so clear, that does not require someone to be a PhD of Arabic to understand.
So the only thing is that once after reading these hadiths and
yes,
there are so many firqas, branches of Islam.
Yeah. You see, this again is a mythology. The difference is not simply because people say some ahadith lead people to disagree. You will find a number of Quranic passages where interpretations are different completely. Read the Quran and you will find its interpretation by Mufassirin completely different. Should we say, since the Quran is interpreted differently, leave the Quran? Is that scientific, logical? Then why we say about Hadith same thing? Why? Yes. 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 Yes.
We should have been on one line all the questions. Why we have not been on one line?
Yes.
There are different platforms.
Whatever was done by the Prophet was endorsed and verified by the Quran in 23 years. Not that Allah was waiting for 23 years and then sent a sealed envelope. In this is the code you follow and all else is void. Therefore, unless an ayah is provided to say, we have abrogated the way of putting your hands on chest or on your navel or leaving on your sides, there is no basis whatsoever for someone to say one is cancelled, other is endorsed. All three will remain the sunnah till day of judgment. And the reason is so obvious. The Quran is universal book. Sunnah is not particular. It's also universal. How can we think Quran till day of judgment and sunnah only for 7th century? Why Prophet was sent? Just to show people in a specific time, or his example was also valid till the day of judgment? Therefore, whatever is being done by him must provide a variety to be followed, and that variety does not mean conflict and contradiction. It only provides flexibility, mobility, and more room for people to act. So I believe this diversity is a blessing. It does not call for calling it contradiction at all. Did you ever hear from any single scholar till today that if you leave your hands on side in prayer, your prayer is false? Did anyone said? Did anyone said you bind your hands, your prayer will be wrong? Read the history and you will find Imam Ash-Shafi, when he was in Madinah Munawwara, prayed by leaving his hands on both sides. And when someone asked him, he said, I'm in the city of Malik. And Malik used to leave his hands on both sides. This is also Sunnah. I want to honor their Sunnah. What's wrong if you are putting your hands on chest and being a Shafi? What's wrong if you put your hands on navel and being a Hanafi? What's wrong if you leave hands on sides and be a Maliki or Jafari? What's wrong in that? What's wrong in that?
There's not wrong in this, sir, but
and no conflict either. There's no conflict either. The Quran also provides for more than one possibilities in many places. Similarly, Hadith provides. And that cannot be a basis for saying that they are different. They have same validity. Sir?
Sir, Sarkar Amna or Badi Ribar
Iske baare mein agar aapko fatwa lena hai, jo kisi mufti sahab se poochiye, main to mufti nahi hoon.
Contradictions jo hai sir, kai dafa dekha gaya hai ki matlab hum bhi kai jagah
ji ji
namaz padte hain.
Ji ji.
Ek incident mere saath hua Gujarat wala mein, I was
ji 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 ji.
Hum ke aage khada ho ke mere piche thodi si dadi wala
ji ji ji.
To ek mashallah kafi lambi chodi dadi wale aur
ji ji.
Kapde pehne se sab
ji ji.
Ye shabd ne namaz ki ji aap to गलत कर रहे हैं, ये आपने सभी डांप आपने फलाना, तो इस किस्म का जो छोटा सा हमारा डाउट क्लियर हो, नॉट एज अ प्रॉब्लम.
देखिए, एक कुरान पाक की आयत में ये बात कही गई है कि अपने दीन में गुलू ना करो. ये कुरान पाक की आयत है. और ये कहा गया है कि बनी इसराइल ने गुलू किया और वो तबाह किए गए. हदीस में ये बात कही गई है कि मुझे भेजा गया है दीन को आसान करने के लिए, मुश्किलात के लिए नहीं. अलैहिस्सलाम ने नमाज अदा फरमाई है जो आप आज तक अदा फरमाते हैं हज के मौके पर बग़ैर सर को ढाके. ऐसा करना सुन्नत साबिता है. ये सुन्नत वो है जो अमल से साबित है 15 सदियों की, जिसे आपने देखा है आँखों से 3 जनरेशन्स के साथ. एक ग्रैंडसन, उसका बाप, उसका ग्रैंडफादर जब एक साथ हज करते हैं तो 3 जनरेशन्स एक साथ ये चीज़ देखती हैं. यू कैन नॉट सी समथिंग रॉन्ग. महज ये ज़ुबानी किताब की बात नहीं है, बल्कि इट्स कन्फर्म्ड. जो मसला सारा हमारा दाढ़ी का है, आप उठा के देखिए तफासीर को और कुतुब हदीस को, और मुझे बताइए कि उनमें से कोई एक आयत, कोई एक हदीस ऐसी है जो दाढ़ी की मकदार का तायुन करती. अजीज़ मन, वही तो आपसे अर्ज़ कर रहा हूँ कि सुनना अलग बात है, मुझे बताया जाए कोई एक हदीस और एक आयत. सिर्फ जिस चीज़ को हमने बुनियाद बनाया है, और ये कोई मैं ख़ुद अर्ज़ नहीं कर रहा, बड़े मशहूर मुफस्सिर हैं हमारे मुल्क के, एक बरेलवी मसलक के, उन्होंने अपनी तफसीर में इन सारे वाक़यात को यकजा करके बयान कर दिया है. सिर्फ एक वाक़या जिसमें कि एक सहाबी दूसरे सहाबी की दाढ़ी को लंबा देख करके मुट्ठी से पकड़ते हैं और उससे ज़ायद जो है उसको काट देते हैं. ये एक सहाबी का अमल है जिसको कि हमें रिपोर्ट किया गया. ये हदीस नहीं है, न हुजूर का फरमान, न कुरान का फरमान. इसकी ताबीर ये की गई कि दाढ़ी कम से कम इतनी हो. लेकिन क्या किसी ने कभी ये गौर किया कि उन्होंने ये क्यों किया? ये इसलिए किया कि दाढ़ी इससे आगे ना बढ़ने पाए. उनका मकसद था मैक्सिमम दिस, humne kaha minimum this. Dono mamle aapki aqal ke hain ya quran o hadith ke hain, kiske hain? Jab insani aqal aayegi beech mein, haram halal ho gaya ya nahi hua? Halal haram kis se hoga? Halal o haram ki buniyad hai quran aur allah ke rasool ka farmaya hua. Agar aap ye baat farma jate, masle ka hal ho jata. Agar sahabi ko ye kehte ki huzur ne ye farmaya, masle ka hal ho jata. Lekin jab ek sahabi ka amal hai jo sabit hai, uski tabir sirf ek hogi ke do hongi, kya hongi? Aur tabir kaun si valid hogi? Kya wajah hai ke sirf ek ho dusri valid na ho? Chunanche hamare is mulk ke ulama aur bahar ke ulama bahut se ye raaye rakhte hain ke daadi ki jo maximum miqdar sahabi ke khayal mein tay payi wo mutti se aage na badhne paaye, isse aage hogi sunnat ke khilaf hogi us riwayat ki roshni mein. Jabki humne ye samajh liya hai ke jitni zyada lambi hogi utni zyada taqwa hoga. Agar us pe bhi gaur kiya jaye jo riwayat hai to riwayat khud ye tay kar deti hai ke isse aage na badhne paaye, ye nahi kehti ke isse kam na ho. Ye simply surat-e-haal hai.